Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the 25th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2023. The first item on the committee's agenda this morning is to agree or not to take agenda items 3, 4 and 5 in private. Are members of the committee content to do that? Yeah, we are agreed. The main item this morning for the committee is agenda item 2, which is a session on the Audit Scotland Accounts Commission Section 23 report into early learning and childcare, particularly the progress on the delivery of the 1140 hours expansion. So I'm pleased that we're joined this morning by four representatives. First of all, Neil Rennick, who's the Director General Education and Justice. Eleanor Passmore, who's the Deputy Director for Early Learning and Childcare in the Scottish Government. And I'm pleased that we're also joined by Matthew Sweeney from COSLA, where he is a Policy Manager for Children and Young People, and also by Joanna Anderson, who's a Policy Manager at COSLA on local government and finance. We've got questions to put to you. Before we get to those, Mr. Rennick, I wonder if you could give an opening statement and then we will ask questions both of yourself, the Scottish Government team and the representatives from COSLA. So, Mr. Rennick, over to you.
Thank you, Convener. I genuinely welcome this opportunity to provide evidence to the committee today. As you know, it's now just over 2 years since all 32 local authorities began delivering 1140 hours of funded early learning and childcare. Achieving this by August 2021 was a significant undertaking, particularly in the face of the COVID-19 pandemic. Working together, colleagues in COSLA and the government developed and delivered a multi-year investment plan, supporting the building of necessary infrastructure and the training and recruitment of the required workforce. Delivering that programme could only have been achieved through strong partnership working between government and local government. I would also like to take the opportunity to recognise those working in the private, third and childminding sectors for the time and effort they have devoted to delivering 1140 and for their continuing work in supporting Scotland's children and families. I'm pleased with the Audit Scotland's assessment that the Scottish Government and councils have made good progress in implementation since the 2020 report that they published. The universal component of the programme is delivered with very high levels of take-up and most parents reporting that they are satisfied with both the quality and flexibility of provision available to them. The latest report from Audit Scotland sets out a number of important recommendations relating to improving planning processes, data collection and data use. As accountable officer, I accept its conclusions. We have work in hand to take all of those recommendations forward. Indeed, progress has already been made on a number of the recommendations, including on data sharing around eligible two-year-olds and on staff movement within the ELC workforce. As outlined in the Audit Scotland report, we recognise the significant impact that the cost crisis has had, particularly on the private, voluntary and childminding sectors. The Scottish Government is committed to continuing to work closely with local government and the sector and respond to those challenges. The committee members will be aware that ministers in their 2023-24 programme for government committed to an uplift in private, voluntary and independent sector workforce of £12 an hour for those delivering funded ELC from April 2024. The programme for government also set out our plans to work over the next year with local government and partners on the next phase of both early learning and school-aged childcare, building on the expansion that was achieved with 1140. We will implement the recommendations and take on the wider learning from Audit Scotland's report to inform that next stage of work, and we're very happy to answer any questions the committee has. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. I think you said in that opening statement that you accept, as the accountable officer, all of the recommendations of this report produced by Audit Scotland and the Accounts Commission. Is that correct, Mr. Rennick?
Yes.
Yes, it is. Thank you. Perhaps I could turn to Mr. Sweeney and ask you that same question. Does COSLA accept the findings and recommendations of this report?
Yeah, absolutely. And as Neil Rennick said, there's already been work that's been ongoing to address some of them.
Thank you very much. Can I turn to something that we took evidence on back in June when the report first came out from the Auditor General? And one of the issues that came up at that point was real an interest on capital spend to deliver these quite ambitious targets. And the evidence we were given at that time was that the Scottish Futures Trust, I think, was going to gather up information on capital spend and try and come up with some estimate of current spend and what future spend might be. I wonder, Mr. Rennick, whether you could update us on where we've got to with that Scottish Futures Trust piece of work.
Yeah, absolutely. I'll bring Eleanor in the detail if that's helpful. But just to confirm, obviously, capital investment and infrastructure was an absolutely crucial element of delivering the 1140. And the Scottish Futures Trusts have not just been involved more recently in looking at the delivery of that, but have been involved throughout, both in terms of providing guidance on the construction of the refurbishment and new facilities, and then also monitoring the delivery of that capital investment. The Scottish Government committed to investing around £476 million in that capital investment, and the vast majority of those projects have now been delivered. The last information I had, but I'll ask Eleanor just to check this, was that nine local authorities had carried forward funding on projects that were still continuing, but that 94% of projects were complete, 2% were under construction, and 4 were still in the development phase, but that the vast majority were delivered, and that the flexibility was available in terms of available capacity. But Eleanor, if there's anything further?
Yeah, that's correct. So I think the evidence you heard previously from Audit Scotland's report drew on information from 2022, which found that 90% were complete. So updated data from May of this year, as Neil said, indicates that 94% of those projects are complete, with 2% in construction and the remaining 4% in the development phase.
OK, thank you. I mean, one of the elements of that we were interested in when we took evidence previously was the factor of construction inflation, which I think was defined as being about 30%, which is considerably more even than the retail price index and the consumer price index. But we weren't clear, and I wonder whether you could shed any light on this, what you've identified as the principal drivers for that inflation in the construction section being, and I don't know whether you can shed any light on that.
Yeah, obviously, as I said, the vast majority of the capital projects within this particular programme have been delivered, so thankfully are not affected by that. We're aware of it impacting across a wide range of policy areas. The causes of that are mixed and complex. They relate partly to do with the impact of Brexit, partly to do with the ongoing impact of supply chain issues, a hangover from COVID as well, and then there has just been a general inflation in the sector, both in terms of workforce and materials as well, and that is impacting across a huge range of areas. As far as I'm aware, we've not been approached by any councils to ask for additional capital funding with reference to any of the projects that are within this programme, but absolutely confirm it is impacting across a wide range of areas, and I suspect this committee will see more of that in other areas.
OK. I mean, to go back to the question that we put to Audit Scotland at the last session, can you broadly, I realise that there is a kind of an aggregation of factors here, but can you broadly say which the biggest driver for that level of inflation in the construction section is? Is it labour? Is it supply chain?
I know colleagues in our capital investment and exchequer teams have been looking at that and have been communicating and assessing what the impacts are. I genuinely think it is a combination of different factors that are driving that. And as I say, I see it in other areas of capital investment that we are supporting.
Okay. I mean, and just on a related point, the Auditor General brought out a briefing recently on infrastructure and the challenges which there are, yes, in delivering the projected budgets. I mean, to what extent do you think those pressures might have an impact on the delivery of infrastructure in the early learning childcare sector?
Yeah, obviously, I've read through the Audit Scotland report, and it confirms it's an issue across almost all of our portfolio, almost all of our portfolio's areas, and yet absolutely we will need to factor that into the next phase of work. The particular phase in the immediate term is not largely focused on infrastructure projects. We have development work in a number of individual local communities that we are working on, but those are not reliant on significant capital investment. And similarly, the expansion that we're continuing to move forward with two-year-olds, there's already capacity built in for the current number of eligible two-year-olds. But Eleanor?
And I think it's something we're very alive to, as Neil said, in terms of planning for the next phase of the expansion. But as we were saying, 6% remain outstanding. So we'll keep in close contact directly and through the SFT with those councils. I think it is worth saying that 82% of the infrastructure investment is being delivered through refurbishment and repurposing or extension of an existing asset. So again, I think that suggests that the risks are kind of manageable in terms of those inflationary impacts.
Right, thank you. I'm going to ask the representatives from COSLA. I mean, Joanna Anderson, I'm sure your ears pricked up when you heard the Director General saying that they had no approaches from any local authority for additional support for capital investment. I mean, what's the perspective on what's happened with capital spending from a local government point of view?
Thank you. So there's obviously, as Neil and Eleanor referred to, there are obviously concerns around inflationary pressures across all kind of council services across the board, and as I've obviously already alluded to as well, there's vast majority of capital projects in terms of ELC expansion have been delivered. I think we also have not had specific concerns raised in terms of the additional costs that are being incurred in terms of ELC expansion capital costs, but obviously it is something that we will keep an eye on and we will monitor that. There is obviously the finance working group, the jointly chaired group, that would be the appropriate space to kind of monitor that and have those discussions. I think in terms of kind of, I think Eleanor's also alluded to the vast majority of projects being refurbishment projects. So those are, it's not the capacity to deliver on expansion is reliant on kind of new build projects that are being held back by inflationary pressures. That's not a kind of huge concern at the moment.
Okay, thanks. That's helpful. I'm going to turn now to Colin Beattie, who's got some questions. Sorry, I should say that we will obviously be asking questions about the operational model and as regards the financing of that at some point. But I'm going to turn to Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Convener. I've just got one or two areas I'd like to explore, and the first is really about deferred entry to primary one and para 20 of the report. There's obviously 10 councils were running a pilot. Now, the pilot evaluation report was published in June on access to funded early learning and childcare for eligible children who defer entry to primary one. What actions is the Scottish Government taking in response to that report?
Yeah, I'll bring colleagues in, but you'll be aware that from August this year, that eligible children are able to defer that entry and get access to early learning and childcare. So that deferral opportunity is there available for children and families. The pilot projects did show some upswing in terms of the number of children or the number of families who were choosing to defer, but that was within the flexibilities available within the programme, and that's still our expectation for this year. Obviously, we'll have full information about how many children have deferred and how that spread across local authority areas when we get the annual statistics in December. Eleanor?
Yeah, I think, as a member will be aware, the kind of Ipsos Mori independent evaluation that we commissioned found that broadly the deferrals policy had been implemented as intended, and we were pleased to see that local authorities also reporting that they were kind of broadly content, and actually I think they saw some benefit in terms of simplifying the process for them. The report also found that it didn't have a major impact on local authority capacity or resources, although as Neil says, that's something something that we'll keep a very close eye on as we get the kind of latest census data later this year. So there were some hot spots that came through in sort of the 10 pilot areas, but I think for those children deferring between August and December, nationally there was a 2 percentage point increase, so from 7% to 9%. So we have seen a change, but I think we're confident based on the kind of analysis from the pilot that, that's manageable. In terms of what action we've been taking, we engage closely with COSLA to ensure that local authorities are communicating with parents. And again, I think one of the findings of the report was that that conversation between parents and kind of trusted professionals in schools and ELCs settings is really critical in informing their choice. So ensuring that that communication continues to happen and keeping a really close eye in terms of the capacity and cost factors as part of the ELC settlement will be another important action that, that we're taking from that.
Maybe I can ask COSLA to come in here. I mean, that sounds fairly positive. Are there any downsides?
So I think the first thing I'd say, I think that the sort of phased approach in was something that was agreed between the Scottish Government and COSLA, and this piloting approach was phased through a joint implementation plan that we created in 2020 when the legislation was introduced for this very purpose, to make sure that we didn't get into a situation where we were coming towards the full legislation coming into effect without an understanding what it's likely to be about capacity. And I think it's been really useful that the learning from the pilots, as Eleanor mentioned, has been understood by local authorities, and they are also able to share their practice with others. I suppose the key point for our members that we've been discussing is around the fact that it feels that it's increasing year on year, and I suppose now that it's a national offer, there probably will be an increase in communications around what that means. So what that's going to mean, as colleagues have alluded to, is we have that really close eye on monitoring to understand what impact that has on uptake. But at the moment, from the pilots, it doesn't look like it's been massive and can broadly be met. But making sure we keep an eye on that as the offer is to parents is understood will be really important.
Nice to hear something positive. Let me move on to something that's less positive. Data. The number of times that we sit in this committee and we hear that there's inadequate data or no data, and this is no different because paragraph 71 talks about a lack of data on the demand for childcare, which seems pretty basic as a statistic that you'd want to help guide where you're investing. So what work's been undertaken to address this lack of national data, both for funded and non-funded?
Yeah, thank you. Obviously, it's one of the key themes that runs consistently through the Audit Scotland report, that issue of data. Coming to this area fresh, not having been involved with it before, I have to say I've been really impressed by the range of information that is available just now in terms of both the number of children who are eligible, the number of children receiving services, a range of different information. But I accept we would always want more data to be available to understand further around what the implications are. Some good progress has already been made around that, particularly around the issue of eligible two-year-olds. And again, we can talk much further about that and the benefits that's delivering. In terms of the 1140, we know that there is exceptionally high take-up of that, so there is clearly demand there for that funded early learning and childcare. Part of the next phase of work that was announced in the programme for government is to do some further work, including through digital technologies, to get a better understanding of what children and families' needs are and how those can be met. So absolutely, that is a key part of the next phase of work that we are doing. I don't know if colleagues want to say any more about that.
I mean, I think the member may be aware that local authorities have a statutory duty to consult with parents and carers every 2 years around kind of local demands and needs. So I think local areas should have that understanding. Nationally, the parent survey that we ran, which was the first national information we had post 1140 and undertaken with 8,000 parents, gave us an understanding both of funded provision and demand for unfunded provision. So we do have some information, and we're developing an ELC outcomes framework jointly with COSLA, looking at the totality of measurement and how we use that information. And so this is going to be one of those kind of critical areas that we look at to consider the feasibility and the approach to gathering further data and existing data, and whether additional approaches are needed to look specifically at that issue of demand. Because there is some information there in the system, I think it's a question of understanding that picture and where further work may be needed.
But this seems to me so fundamental. If you don't know what the demand is nationally, how do you put resources behind that? How do you know what resources councils are going to need? How do you know what resource the government's going to have to allocate? And yes, you're talking about some local data that might be available, which is helpful, but clearly that is not available across the board. Not all councils are producing the data, otherwise you would be collating it.
All the councils should be drawing that data together in terms of their local needs, and that is reported in terms of the survey of parents. So we do have that information. As I say, we know that there is exceptionally high take up of the 1140 offer. Part of what we've reflected is obviously that for families, it's not just about early learning and childcare, that for many families it will also be the combination of early learning and childcare and school-age childcare. So a large part of the work that we're taking forward in the next phase is thinking about those family units and how you create a system that supports families in the whole, and clearly lots of families have different needs. Positively, the work in terms of the parent survey indicates that the majority of parents and families are happy with the flexibility that the current 1140 offer provides for them. But clearly, we always want to do more work to make sure that we are matching up what needs and expectations of families are with the offer that's available.
If the councils are collecting all this data, are they using a common process to do it, common data sets to do it, so that they're comparable and so that you can collate them nationally?
Yeah, there's a statutory duty on the local authorities to collect that data, but also then to analyse it locally and develop their own local plans of how they want to respond to that, taking account of local circumstances.
But if I'm comparing one council to the other, would I be able to compare apples with apples?
I think the important thing to come back to with the consultation duty is how it works with the other duties on councils and their responsibilities under the Funding Follows the Child, which is the model agreed by the Scottish Government and COSLA in terms of how we're running the expansion and the way that works. The idea in that consultation is to make sure that we have that understanding of what local needs are at the local level. I'm not sure if any point in the process that was designed to provide that sort of national comparison, because fundamentally what's important is that there's that range of models and options open to parents at the local level. And I think some of the data that Eleanor mentioned, we do have some of the national level parents' data, which seems to broadly back up that consultation process is working, because we've got that global figure where we're saying the vast majority of families are fairly happy with both the quality and the flexibility of the provision locally.
I think in the middle of all this, what you're saying is local authorities are collecting information in a manner which suits them locally, but may not be capable of being collated at a national level into something that can be used by the government. Is that correct?
Mr. Beattie is right. That's exactly what we need to look at as part of the ELC outcomes framework, and recognising as well that local authorities also collect other data that informs the census, for example, and we're carrying out improvement work through the CMIS project that will give us much better information around that. So we need to look at the totality of requests and information that we're gathering from local authorities and also nationally to make sure that we can do that consistent piece. And that's exactly, that is part of the scope of the outcomes framework work. But it's to look in the round, because there's a number of sources of data and we want to make sure that we're collecting it in the right way and using it for the right purposes, and also that it's useful and proportionate. So absolutely, demand is a critical component of that, as well as other factors, including better demographic information about children with additional support needs is a critical one. So we're looking at data in the round, and absolutely that's a really key part of that work.
I think in the middle of this, we have to remember that the Auditor General's report here makes it clear that we don't have national data on the demand for childcare, which to me seems a very basic piece of data that should be getting collected. And if it's being collected locally to suit local conditions, that's fine. But how do you collate that nationally and make sense of it on a national basis? And that's clearly what's not happening. And, you know, however positive you may put this, at the end of the day, the national data isn't there.
it's important to say we do have national data, obviously, on a consistent basis in terms of the delivery of the 1140 for each local authority, what's been delivered, the number of children, the take-up, etc., additional support needs. So there is a range of data in terms of the delivery of 1140. Obviously, that issue in terms of what parents' expectations and demands are, we have a national picture from the survey we undertake of parents, but alongside that, quite rightly, local authorities undertake local assessments of what the needs are and try and match that up with the local delivery.
I mean, without information on demand, you're not going to be able to work out workforce planning, you're not going to be able to do proper budgeting and so on, and that's clearly what this is aimed at here. When do you expect to have that national data on the demand for childcare?
Well, in terms of the 1140, obviously, we did have that and built that into the workforce plans. Every 2 years, local authorities do that analysis of what the local needs are. So that information is there. Obviously, as we move into the next phase of the work around both early learning and childcare and the school-aged childcare, we will build into that analysis of the workforce needs. And in fact, that's part of the work that Eleanor was describing in terms of looking ahead to what the workforce demands are going forward.
So I think just to add to that, absolutely, as I said earlier, we'll look at the best way to ensure that we're able to gather a national picture on demand and that that's robust and effective. I think it's worth differentiating between workforce planning for the funded childcare offer, and obviously there are workforce issues in terms of the sort of nearly 50% that private providers are funded directly by parents to provide. And so the role of national government is different with regard to that. So we undertake a lot of work in terms of the full sector sustainability. But in terms of our responsibilities and in terms of 1140, that's specifically have been around workforce planning around the funded entitlement.
Yeah, it's worth saying we know that not all parents take up the full 1140 offer, that a number don't, and that the survey indicates that's by choice, that they choose not to take it up for a variety of reasons.
OK, I'll move on from that, but I can't say I'm terribly convinced of what you're saying. Move on to looking at the views of children and, specifically looking at the Article 12 of the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child. How is the Scottish Government progressing the recommendation in the Auditor's General Report, that's paragraph 103, to capture and consider children's views as part of the future evaluation of the policy? As I say, that's in line with Article 12 of the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child.
Absolutely. It's important to say that as part of the health and social care standards, they already include an expectation that service providers are taking count of children's views and respecting those in terms of how they are individually delivering services for those children. Earlier this year, the Scottish Government published the Voice of the Infant best practice guidance and an infant pledge to try and improve consistency across a range of services in terms of listening to very young children, and that includes a good practice that includes good practice examples, including from the early learning.
How are you actually listening to the views of the child?
Yeah, there's a lot of work that's been going on more broadly linked with the incorporation of the UNCRC about how you engage with very young children and take their views. And as I say, that best practice guidance makes some suggestions. Now, clearly, parents have an important role in advocating for very young children, but also part of it is about ensuring that you find ways to listen to children directly as well on what their experiences are. And there's lots of relatively recent analysis and guidance on how to do that.
What are these ways?
Still developing it. Well, within individual settings, there are different ways in which they record children's views in terms of how they are feeling each day, how they feel about the services they receive, how they feel about the food, etc. So there are experts in that, and local delivery agencies receive training in terms of how to engage with children.
Once again, is that engagement common across all council areas?
It's one of the standards within the health and social care standards, so that should be being looked at by the care inspectorate in terms of looking at what services are doing.
So each local authority is doing the same thing and doing the same evaluation so that nationally they can be collated?
The standards, I'll let Eleanor come in, the standards are consistent across all providers.
So in terms of day-to-day practice, realising the ambition, which is well evidence-based practice guidance, is really clear about the importance of play pedagogy and engaging children and improving the kind of practice of practitioners. In terms of the evaluation, as you'll be aware, we published our evaluation strategy last October, which set out the full suite of how we're approaching that in a really detailed way. So this year, a critical part of that is the Scottish study of early learning and childcare and the kind of second phase of that being completed post-evaluation. In tandem to that, we're engaging with colleagues at the National Day Nursery Association and with others through our monitoring and evaluation working group to explore how we look at children's views in evaluation specifically in a meaningful way, because obviously there's a difference between day-to-day practice and looking at how you evaluate a national expansion at a policy level. And NDNA have done some thinking around that that we want to draw on to make sure that we do that in a really robust and evidence-based way. So we're taking forward that work as part of the evaluation implementation. And the totality of that evaluation we expect to report in 2025, but we'll publish components of that as it progresses over a number of years. So there's a number of big components to that. Obviously, children's views are a really critical part of it, as Neil has outlined, and we're looking really carefully as part of our kind of monitoring evaluation group at how we do that effectively.
What you've said is you're already collecting the views of children through the local authorities, and it's done on a common basis. So that information is then fed to you nationally. How is it fed to you nationally? And how do you evaluate what lands on your desk to ensure that these views are taken into consideration when policy is being decided?
In terms of the local, in terms of in the local context of each individual provider, that will be being assessed by the care inspector and reflected in there, and the advice that they feed back to the individual service in terms of their improvement. As Eleanor says, we're doing some wider work around the evaluation of how we draw in children's views as part of.
What I'm interested in seeing is how children are able to input into government policy.
Yeah. That's part of the evaluation work will be to do
all the work you're talking about is at a local level. I'm not seeing really how this is feeding into any policy.
Yeah, the evaluation framework that was published last October includes the information around how we're trying to draw in children's views as part of the evaluation of the programme, as opposed to how individual children are feeling about the services that they're receiving locally in terms of early learning and childcare.
Okay, thank you, Mina.
Okay, thanks. I want to take you back to the questions about demand for childcare and how that's been assessed and what data has been collected, because I think on that question both Willie Coffey and Graeme Simpson wanted to come in, but Colin Beattie was on a roll, so I let him continue. So I'm going to go to Willie first of all. Do you want to come in on that question before you get on to the other questions you've got, and I'll bring Graeme in on this data set stuff as well.
Right.
Willie.
Convener. Just to return briefly to the data gathering issue, just about every time we come to the audit committee and look at a report from the Auditor General, there's always an issue about data gathering. Every time. If you were a betting man, you could put a bet that his next report will also include that. So I kind of wonder why that is in general, why we continue to ask questions about data during the course of a particular piece of work. Do you think there might be a chance to think about defining what a data gathering standard actually should be in advance of a piece of work, so that when work gets underway, the participants, those that are delivering the service for us, have an idea of the range of data that's expected to be gathered? Because that, in my mind, Neil, would assist the councils to have a consistency of type of data that they're gathering, so that the national picture could be built up that Colin was referring to. But I feel that we don't do that in advance. If I'm wrong, then please correct me, but do you get a sense that that might be something worthwhile doing, that we look across the board at the types of data that we would want and define it and gather it as we go, so that one day in the future the Auditor General might not point that out in one of his future reports?
It's a really interesting question. It's one I've been reflecting on in terms of, you know, thinking about the report and what it's saying. And as I said earlier, coming to this fresh, I've actually been really impressed by the range of data that's available in terms of understanding how the 1140 has been delivered and the impact that's having. At the start of it, baseline data was collected, and as Eleanor has described, we have set out an evaluation framework that has a range of different indicators and data that we will draw on to try and assess in terms of the impact that this policy is having for children and families, in terms of take-up, in terms of flexibility, in terms of quality, but also looking at the bigger picture in terms of the financial impact and the value for money. So that is built into the process. But obviously, as we go on with the project, it always becomes clear that there is more data that it would be useful to have. There's been a particular issue in terms of data around eligible two-year-olds that, again, we can describe further. But, yeah, I suspect it will always be the case that in whatever policy we develop, there will always be a desire for more information to try and improve and refine the what we're delivering and how we're assessing its impact.
But is it because we haven't thought about it up front to do that piece of work, to think about data, the range of data, define it almost as a standard? It's as almost as if we discover it midway or partway through the process. Oh, we need that data. We should have thought about it at the beginning, should we not?
Yeah, and again, coming to this fresh, my impression is that a lot of work was done at the beginning to try and analyse what baseline data was required and how to monitor that. But inevitably, with a programme this size, then we will find out that there's further data that we need. Equally, there were some recognised particular issues in terms of the IT systems that were available to local government in terms of what we were able to collect and share at a local authority and a national level, and that was partly reflected in some of the work that's gone into investment in the IT system. So it was recognised that we didn't have the full suite of data that we would want, and work has gone on alongside the delivery of 1140 to try and expand that access to data. I don't know if colleagues wanted to say anything further.
I think I agree absolutely, I think, on that question. I think there's also something about, as Neil Rennick said, that actually over time there is new interest. So, for example, the children's rights journey, obviously that's been a renewed interest with the incorporation. So that's probably an angle that we thought about, but probably not in the same degree of where data was collected and what was different around at the local level versus needs to be part of a national evaluation. So some of these things happen as part of that. And I think the other thing to mention, obviously, is the Verity House Agreement that's existing between the Scottish Government and local government. And actually part of that process is looking at a framework for monitoring assurance. And I think it's asking that very question about actually what is the right data that we need to have held locally? What's the right things that we need nationally to understand how services are being delivered and how we inform national policy? And I think we're just at the start of that process, but I think there's a lot in there which I think answers the question you're looking at.
Okay, many thanks for answering that supplementary. Thank you.
Thanks again. On a similar theme, I think Graeme Simpson wanted to come in on this question as well.
Yeah, thanks very much, Convener. So Mr. Rennick, you said that the take up of 1140 hours has been high. So how many children are getting 1140 hours?
Yeah, so as we currently have the analysis that of the number of children who are eligible for funded early learning and childcare, we are currently running at 99% of children receiving that level of childcare. In terms of the numbers who are accessing 600, I don't have the data right in front of me, so I'm going to bring Eleanor in while I hunt for it.
So the census data that we publish each year, and the most recent one from last year shows there were 92,500 children accessing funded ELC across Scotland, which is a 1% increase from the previous year. So in terms of uptake for the universal offer, so for 3 and 4 year olds, that increased again over the same period from 97% to 99%. And we think there may have been a COVID impact in there and that slight change. With regards to two-year-olds, it's a more complex picture. So that, as you'll be aware, is a targeted offer. So it's available to children on certain benefits and also to families and children with care experience. So we've had an issue on the data there because it's been reliant on data owned by the UK government and have been through an extensive process to ensure that data sharing arrangements are in place. And as Audit Scotland reported, the legislation was passed by the UK Parliament last October. As of June this year, local authorities have had
been able to sign agreements to access that data. So that this means that from the census this year, for the first time, we will have an accurate picture of the eligible population as well as uptake. So we've estimated that it's been around 25% have been eligible, and then we've had the total number of registrations against that. So 7,042 last year, which was 14% of the total population rather than the eligible population. So that's the information that we'll have this year, and we'll publish that broken down by local authority area.
Sorry, I just found the figure. So the difference in terms of those taking up the full 1140 was 84%, and then those taking 600 or more hours was the 99% that Eleanor mentioned.
Sorry, say that again.
So 84.4%, according to the Improvement Service latest statistics, were taking the full 1140, and then effectively 99% were taking the over 600 hours, so between the 600 and the 1140.
I have mentioned the data improvement process. So the census is the most robust data that we have. The CMIS improvement programme will enable us to have better information about hours, about demographic profile of families accessing the children accessing it. At the moment, we don't have that through the census, which is why we commissioned the Improvement Service to carry out that kind of further survey work in year to give us that really critical picture around how many families are taking up the full 1140 hours versus over the 600, and also to give us some sort of further delivery information while that improvement project, the census, is taking place.
Okay, so let's just drill down into that a bit. Mr. Rennick, I think you said that 84% of eligible children are taking up the 1140 hours. But then earlier you said that 99% are receiving it.
Yeah, sorry, 99% are of eligible children are receiving funded early learning and childcare. A number of families choose not to make use of the full 1140 within that, so they will receive a lower number than that, but that is a choice that they are making. It's not mandatory to take up the 1140 hours.
So 99% get something,
yes.
Take something,
yeah.
But 84%... take the full amount.
Yeah, but the vast majority are taking over 600 hours.
Right, and when I asked for the overall figure earlier, you gave a figure of 92,500. Is that the number that are taking the 1140 hours?
No, so no. That's the registration day. So that's the number of children in services, funded services, taking a place. And then, as Neil alluded to, the 84% relates to the number taking the full 1140 hours. If it's helpful to reflect, in terms of the parent survey that I mentioned from last December, we asked the question around why families were not perhaps opting to use the full 1140, and the majority said that that was a matter of choice. For a minority, I think around 20%, that they said that there were issues around kind of flexibility and being able to access and the choice of provider, or that they would wish, or the sort of package of hours that they would want. So we know that there are issues around that, but the majority are kind of content overall with the flexibility on offer. But as Neil said, it's not a mandatory offer. There will always be reasons why families may not wish to take up the full hours. So we kind of think about that in terms of our understanding of the evaluation and in terms of kind of what data we are seeing around uptake and usage.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a choice for parents. So the 84% who are taking up the 1140 hours, what's the number that are?
I need to do my calculation in my head of what 84% of 92,000 is, but it'll be.
So there is a difference because the data sources are different, which may be a source of slight confusion.
It's all right, we can work.
So I can pick that out.
Don't worry. So just one more question on data, and it was something the Auditor General said right at the start of his report. The Scottish Government doesn't know how much has been spent by councils on phasing in the additional hours between 2018-19 and 21-22. Is that correct?
It's a really important question and a point, and one that I'm keen to discuss further with Audit Scotland more broadly. We know how much we are spending on early learning and childcare now. We know how much local authorities were spending on early learning and childcare, on 600 hours of early learning and childcare back in 2017 before the expansion happened. So we know how much extra we're paying to deliver the 1140 offer. What we're not able to do is to say how much of the current spending is going towards 600 hours, how much is going towards the 1140, because clearly that's not the way in which families use the service, and that's not the way in which it's delivered by providers. So we do have a good understanding of what we're spending. We do have a good understanding of what we spent previously before the expansion of that. What we're not able to do is say, what would we be spending now in terms of delivering that 600 hours, because okay. The services are now delivering that wider offer. As part of the evaluation framework that we described earlier, that includes a specific strand that is focused on this issue of finance and value for money and assessing the amount of money that we have spent and what that is delivering, not just in terms of delivering the number of hours, but the economic benefit that is delivering in terms of value for money. But I think there is an interesting question there from Audit Scotland in terms of, in a live system where we are applying expansion to an existing system, how do we assess what difference that expansion is making? And certainly from my past, I remember we faced similar issues with free personal care where that was becoming available on top of existing adult social care services. But Eleanor, anything further than that?
So Eleanor, I mean, Mr. Rennick said he had two figures there. Are you able to give us the two figures? What was spent before? What's spent now?
They're in the Audit Scotland.
So I'm afraid I don't have the pre-expansion figures to hand, but current spend is £521.9 million that's ring-fenced and £474 that sits within the general spending line for kind of local government. I think that's also kind of part of the complexity that Audit Scotland have drawn out in terms of assessing cost and spend, which we've looked at. So I think it's worth reflecting that the local finance returns, which are the kind of audited accounts and the best quality data that we have in terms of spend on pre-primary education, we're pretty confident that 95% of that spend is on ELC, but we're undertaking further work to ensure that we can differentiate between the 1140 and other areas of pre-primary spend. So we're doing some quality improvement work there. But as Neil said, in terms of the before and after picture, we're going to look at that carefully through the evaluation. We did run jointly with COSLA three data collection exercises during the expansion to try to get a kind of better picture of spend. I think part of the challenge, as Neil alluded to, is that services will already be delivering 600 hours, will be using that cost base in terms of estates, in terms of staff, in terms of kind of, you know, shared resources already. So it can be hard for them to differentiate what's a kind of marginal extra hour of provision from 600 hours between 1140. And I think the other thing to perhaps flag that is a challenge that we'll reflect on hard as we deliver the next phase of the expansion is that local authorities, and this was a kind of decision that was agreed as part of the planning process, I believe, implemented the expansion in slightly different ways. So some opted to kind of go early with 1140 implemented from a certain point in time. Others phased it in 600 in an incremental way. So again, taking a point in time snapshot of that made it more challenging to understand kind of, you know, what the kind of precise costs were at a point in time as the expansion was being delivered. But I think that's something, one of the recommendations we're considering very carefully as we look at plans for the next phase of the expansion.
Thank you.
Thanks. I mean, there is a striking implementation gap here, isn't there? And I'm thinking in particular about those eligible two-year-olds. So it's targeted according to people's benefit receipts and care experience of either parent or the child. So an extremely important group, which is very much a priority for the Scottish Government through the promise and other work that has been carried out. But these two-year-olds are only two once, aren't they? So if this programme's been in place since August 2021 and we're now at October 2023 and you didn't know who these children were, that means an awful lot of children have missed out on an opportunity for early learning that was stated as a matter of public priority and an imperative public policy. How do you answer that?
Obviously, we have been recording information on the delivery of early learning and childcare and the hours for two-year-olds. So the census in December showed that the highest ever number of two-year-olds were accessing funded early learning and childcare. Over 7,000 children, two-year-olds, were receiving that service. The challenge we were facing for ourselves and for councils was in identifying those children who were eligible and comparing that delivery to the number of eligible children, and that was reliant on having information about benefits uptake of individual parents. We didn't have a data sharing agreement in place with the UK government to be able to get that information, or at least allow local authorities to access that information. That is now in place since the summer, so that information is now available, and this census this December will be the first time that we'll be able to look at the number of two-year-olds receiving and eligible levels. But more importantly, local authorities are now able to engage with those, identify and engage with those families and make them aware that that service is available.
And the thing I would say is I think that local authorities have found it challenging to engage with those children, not having the exact data. But they have taken a number of approaches, which I think is reflected in the fact that there have been increases in the two-year-old uptake year on year. They've worked with family nursing partnerships and health visitors to see if there's ways that they can identify families through that. They've taken part in community engagement exercises as well. So whilst the work on the data has been ongoing, there has been work by councils to see what they can do to maximise the uptake, noting it's quite a hard job without that data.
But this is an entitlement that those families and those children were entitled to, which doesn't appear to have been fulfilled. And it is a failing, isn't it, of this part of the policy?
It is a challenge in terms of that being able to identify those eligible children, because it was targeted at particular families. Then we had to have that data available, and that was reliant on the UK government agreeing to share that data. Obviously, we take our responsibilities in terms of data handling and data sharing very seriously, so we had to ensure that that was in place before information could be shared. I wish it had been earlier, but I am glad that that is now in place and that councils are able to identify that. Eleanor, I don't know if there's anything further we can say on that.
I mean, I think it's, you know, it has been a source of some frustration that we weren't able to access that data sooner. I think ministers and officials have sought to progress that work as fast as possible and to escalate this as an issue with UK government ministers. But the provisions of the Digital Economy Act 2017 are kind of clear in terms of what steps had to be taken. And, you know, we've worked closely with Cabinet Office, HMRC and DWP to kind of progress that work as fast as we can. And as Matthew's alluded to, councils have not been standing still, and we've also been working closely with the Improvement Service to support councils to maximise uptake as far as possible in the absence of that data.
But this was a stated Scottish Government policy, wasn't it? I know that's the point Mr Simpson's going to make, but I mean, I understand what you're saying about the availability of data sharing and so on, but if the Scottish Government announces a policy, Parliament legislates for that policy, but we are unable to deliver it, it becomes a rather hollow promise, doesn't it? You don't need to answer that question, Al, but I'll bring Graeme Simpson in.
Yeah, convener, it was the same point, really. I mean, so essentially you're saying we had this policy where two-year-olds could access 1140 hours, but we had no way of letting their parents know about it.
I think, as Matthew said, efforts were made by local authorities to contact families, make them aware of this availability. What we didn't have was data that was held by the UK government that could be shared that would allow us to specifically identify those children.
So should that not have been put in place before you rolled out the policy? That's the point, isn't it?
My understanding is that at the time that the policy was agreed, social security powers were not in place to enable the Scottish Parliament to kind of legislate itself and to set eligibility criteria based around kind of benefits. So that position has changed. I think we're looking carefully at eligibility for the totality of the childcare offers, including kind of new benefits that have come on stream since 2014, when I think the policy was first conceived.
Okay, I mean, Exhibit 4 in the Accounts Commission Audit Scotland report gives examples of data gaps, and we'll say a little bit more about those again, I'm sure. But one of the ones which is listed there where there is a data gap is the extent to which children with additional support needs are not accessing funded early learning and childcare, and the extent of any unmet needs. So again, here is another targeted group, an especially important group, where there is a significant gap in the data available.
Obviously, I think we would all agree it's especially important that children with additional support needs and their families have appropriate access to early learning and childcare and the support that they receive. We do have information, and that is included as part of the census information each year, on the number of eligible children who are receiving funded early learning and childcare and the proportion of those who have additional support needs. So as I said earlier on, effectively for 3 and 4 year olds, access to funded early learning and childcare at the level that the parents are looking for is universally available. So that includes children with additional support needs. Our census data indicates that that's around 18% of children, so a significant proportion of children with additional support needs are receiving that funded service. We also know from the parent survey that the vast majority of parents of children with additional support needs are accessing the service and are, in 84% of cases, happy with the service that is being provided. What we don't have is specific information on the number of families with children with additional support needs who are not able to access the full 1140 because of, for example, access issues in terms of the types of service, although clearly they, as I say, universally 3 and 4 year olds are accessing the service and the vast majority of parents are happy with the service that they've got. And equally, we face the same issues in terms of 2 year olds with additional support needs as we have with other 2 year olds. So it is not the case that there isn't information about the number of children accessing early learning and childcare with additional support needs, but there are some of the similar gaps that apply for the data provision as a whole.
But again, Mr. Renning, I think our view would be that this ought to be a priority group. Yes. And if anybody was missing out on the offer of childcare and early learning, it shouldn't be this group that's missing out on it, I think would be our view. And you've spoken quite a lot about the surveys, and we get the importance of surveys in helping to inform policy. But it's really the raw data, isn't it, that ought to lead the policy. It's the evidence and where there is demand and whether it's been met and where there are target groups and are they accessing the promise that's been given to them that they should be accessing. So that I think the committee's view is likely to be that kind of customer surveys and that kind of sampling exercise is useful. But it's this hard data that we're interested in and asking why you're not capturing that.
That's a really important point. We are capturing hard data. That is in the...
But is it the right hard data?
Yes. So what we have here is the information that shows that 99% of eligible children are receiving funded early learning and childcare. And of those children, 18% have an additional support need. So we know for 3 and 4 year olds that those children are receiving funded early learning and childcare. That is hard data shown for each local authority area that we publish each December in the early learning and childcare census. So that hard data is available. Clearly, we would like further data in terms of more information. We know that a number of families say that while they ultimately access services that they're happy with, they report finding it harder to access those services than other parents. We obviously would want to know further information about ensuring that families are happy with the quality of support that they're receiving and that's reflecting the particular needs of their children. And again, in the survey, in the annual census, we record information on the different types of additional support needs that children have and how those are being reflected. So we do have hard data, but I think it refers back to the point that Mr. Coffey was making earlier on. We would always want more information to understand more about what the needs of parents are and try and reflect that. But I am personally reassured that the families of disabled children are accessing that funded early learning and childcare for 3- and 4-year-olds in the same way as other parents are.
And just briefly to add, I think local authorities obviously take their responsibilities around additional support needs, and obviously they have that duty. That the question about data is different from what's delivered, obviously, and what's captured are two slightly separate things. And obviously, there's a huge amount of work that goes on from local authorities to support children and young people with additional support needs. And I think it's also important that we look across to the work that exists in terms of Angela Morgan's report and the work that's followed out in terms of the joint project board that exists between the Scottish Government and COSLA, which is looking at additional support needs in the round and what more we can do. That's not just in early learning and childcare, but also at schools as well, and really important. There's a lot of really challenging things. We've seen changes in demand in terms of we've seen increases in numbers of additional support needs in the last 10 years or so. So how do we work to improve those services is a really active process that local authorities are working on just now.
Maybe one other area obviously we're very concerned about is those children with particular needs and disabilities, and there's been specific work done around those with higher level needs. Eleanor?
Yes, so there was a report earlier this year from the Scottish Centre, SCCMN, I've forgotten the acronym, which is terrible, but it produced a report looking at the needs of children with very acute needs, which is obviously, a relatively small number of children across Scotland with very acute needs. So we've looked carefully at the findings from that report. The Minister chaired a working group over the summer, and we're working with them on the actions that were set out in that. As Matthew says, it's not just about the data, it's what action we're taking. And so we're looking really carefully about nationally what further might be required for those children where local authorities have a relatively small number, but their needs are particularly high.
OK, thank you. I'm not sure that we accept that data and delivery are two entirely separate entities. I think there's an extremely strong relationship between the two. Willie Coffey's got some questions to put to you.
Thanks again, Convener. I just wanted to nip back to infrastructure for a moment, Neil, if I may. It was raised earlier on in the discussion with the Convener, but my focus is to ask you about how well we are set up to achieve our net zero targets with the existing infrastructure that we use. I would imagine that most of the early learning facilities that we have may not be net zero compliant at the moment. So is the government thinking about the extent of that issue and how we will achieve that going forward?
Yeah, thank you. It's an incredibly important issue across all of our capital projects and responsibilities. I think, as Eleanor mentioned earlier on, the vast majority of the infrastructure projects specifically related to this programme in terms of early learning and childcare were refurbishments. So they were refurbishments of existing facilities. So that was 82% of the capital projects were not new build. And clearly that's part of our net zero, is reusing existing buildings rather than the new build. The Scottish Futures Trust has published a suite of guidance for public sector construction projects specifically on net zero building standards and how to ensure that we're building net zero into that, and early learning and childcare settings where some of the specific Pathfinder projects that were included within there, both in terms of standalone facilities and then facilities within existing primary schools. But yeah, we would always like to go further and do more, and in terms of the next phase, ensuring that we're building in net zero into any infrastructure projects will be a key part of the next stage.
What about the retrofitting side of this, though? I'm scared to ask, is there any data that would tell us what the estimated cost of that could be?
That's when I'd say, unless colleagues are aware, that's when I'd have to come back on. I know that the Scottish Futures Trust are doing a lot of work, both looking at what we've already done in terms of this area, but more broadly at what the costs are for the public sector in terms of driving forward with net zero. But that's not something I've got immediately to hand.
I'm sure the committee might be interested in that and following through with that, if we may. Just another question I have. There was a little quibble in the paper describing a 9.1 million pound less allocation to fund early learning childcare. It's in the Auditor General's report, and there was a little issue between COSLA and the Scottish Government about whether that was fair and so on. But there's an explanation in paragraph 64 about the reasons for that. Neil, I wonder if you could expand and explain what the reason for that 9.1 million shortfall is.
Yeah, it was always intended that this was a multi-year programme with multi-year commitments in terms of funding that was based on the data in terms of the numbers of children and young people at the time. We recognised the impact that COVID had on local authorities, so we allowed flexibility in terms of the use of that money in 2020-21. So obviously 21-22 with the implementation was the first year that we were getting information on what the full costs for local authorities actually were, taking account of the fact that that was partway through the year. What that indicated was that the number of eligible children that were in place at that time were lower than the projections that we made at the beginning of the programme, and an adjustment was made to the budget in subsequent years to reflect our assessment of that lower level of demand. That was discussed with COSLA through the joint working arrangements that we have. There will always be discussion and debate about what the right level of funding was, but we were confident that was the right level of funding in terms of being able to deliver the 1140 commitment. But it is absolutely vital that we continue to engage with COSLA and agree that the resources are in place, both for what's currently being delivered and for the next phase of work, and that will absolutely be reflected in the future work.
Was COSLA happy with that explanation?
I think, as the report sets out, it is one of the few areas where there is a difference of opinion. I think it's about the impact that the reducing population has. I think the COSLA leaders have always been very clear that the reducing population doesn't directly translate into kind of a reduction in savings, largely due to the fixed costs that will be there regardless for rent, utilities, etc. and settings. I think, as Neil says, it's an area of joint discussion. The quantum for delivering ELC is something that we will continue to engage with Scottish Government on, and through the finance working group arrangements, they're kind of well set up for that joint discussion on the quantum.
Okay, I understand. Just have one final question, if I may, Convener. I mean, it's £1 billion programme. The principal aims behind it are to reduce child poverty and help support economic transformation. And in your opening remarks, Neil, you reminded us that it's been running for 2 years now and all 32 councils are delivering the 1140. So back to data again. How successful is the programme in the government's view at this moment in time? I know the Auditor General will look at it, but with 2 years' worth of experience in service delivery and the response from parents and so on, what's the government's view on how successful these principal aims have been and whether they've been met so far?
Yeah, in terms of the data that we've got available just now, in terms of take-up and parents' views, and as the convener said, this always has to be a combination of the data, the hard data in terms of pure numbers, and the views of the views of parents and ultimately children as well. So from a personal point of view, looking at the analysis in terms of what we see effectively universally for 3 and 4 year olds, children are taking up funded early learning and childcare places, the vast majority of those at the full 1140 hours. In terms of the parent survey, 88% of parents are satisfied that the service is meeting their needs, so it's matching with what they are needing in terms of the different demands on their time. 97% are happy with the quality that is the quality of their provider, and 97% are happy that it's accessible in terms of travelling to it. So, you know, in terms of delivering the number of hours and families being satisfied with what they are getting, and then also the Care Commission confirming that the vast majority of providers are operating with a good quality, then those feel like good indicators that the programme is delivering. But we were always clear it needed to continue being reviewed, and that we needed a fuller evaluation, not just of what's been delivered, but the impact of that. So the evaluation framework that we published last year specifically set out a set of areas in which we would draw information together. not just about take-up and quality and flexibility, but also what the financial impact is in terms of the wider economy, accessing work, etc. as well. And it's that evaluation, an interim evaluation report will be published next year, and then the final report is due to be published in 2025, and that will give us the fuller picture in terms of what this programme has delivered. But in terms of the immediate data that we've got available, I think all the indicators are positive and reflect well on the work that, that local authorities and private sector providers have done.
So that was a long answer to that.
Sorry.
So at the moment, we don't have data that tells us whether we've managed to reduce child poverty. We don't have that. Because of the programme's been running for 2 years, we don't have any data that supports the principal aim behind the policy.
Specific to this, not in that. We obviously we do have wider data in terms of the movements in child poverty. What we do know is that when parents are asked what's the main reason for which they use the additional hours of early learning and childcare, they say it's for being able to work or search for work or plan for the future. So that would give me an indication that parents are using it for that. But I think Eleanor wanted to come in.
So I just might come in terms of there's a really strong international evidence base that high quality early learning and childcare for the age cohort that this programme targets delivers significant difference to children's lives over the life course. And that's the evidence based approach we've taken. And so in terms of the kind of quality has been at the heart of the expansion, I think we're encouraged that 89% of services are rated as high quality across those four domains that the care inspector inspect on, so we absolutely expect that to deliver in terms of that particular domain and in terms of parent satisfaction. In terms of child poverty, obviously what's critical is parental employment, and that's again one of the three outcomes that we're seeking to deliver. So we have some early data on that. I think 74% of parents report that the expansion has supported them to work or to find work, which is positive, but the full evaluation is required, and you would expect us to be carrying out a robust economic evaluation to understand kind of what the direct impact has been in terms of the wider economic impacts, and that work is underway.
Okay, I'll look forward to seeing more of that data as that emerges as well, Convener. Thank you very much for answering those questions.
Thanks, Willie, and I hope that one of the outcomes that's measured isn't just economistic, but it is also about the flowering of the human spirit, and how it will help these young people, children going through this, to prosper in the future, not just as an economic unit, but as a human being.
Thank you. No, it's a really important point, Convener. So the three elements that we are looking at as part of the evaluation is what is the impact for the children and young people themselves, what experience have they gained from the expansion of early learning and childcare, and that is very much based on pedagogy in terms of what is good for children and young people in terms of play and learning. What impact has it had for families in terms of the benefits for them, not just in economic terms, but more generally, and then that economic analysis. So you're absolutely right, it has to have all those elements to it to be to analyse whether it's been a successfully delivered programme.
Good, right. Graeme Simpson wants to ask some questions. Graeme.
Yeah, thanks again, Convener. And it just follows up on the questions around funding. Hopefully, all of you will have seen the reports based on a survey from the National Day Nurseries Association. So that was reported yesterday. And their members have got real, real concerns about funding. I think these questions are probably directed at COSLA rather than the Scottish Government. But you can, obviously Mr. Rennie can come in if you want. So they're saying that childcare businesses in around a third of councils have started the academic year without knowing how much they're being paid for funded places. Would you accept that?
I wouldn't know the detail of that. I'm not seeing the detail of that, Sophie, fully. What I would say is there is often different approaches that are taken to when councils set up their contracting arrangements, which will mean that there are different times when funding rates are confirmed. Often I know, and what's happened in the past, is that if there has not been a decision taking on the uplift at that stage, when a decision is taken, it's then backdated.
You don't have the details. Well, let me quote what the study says. So 56%, that's 18 councils, were committed to increasing their funding rates. This ranged from 1.35% uplift in Falkirk to 15.48% in the Shetland Islands. And the NDNA say the average increase in hourly rates is just 36 pence an hour for children over three. So, you know, that is putting their members in a pretty perilous position, because, you know, a lot of, you know, their members in quite a good number of council areas don't know what they're going to get.
So maybe it'd be helpful to go into somewhat the guidance and approach that's been agreed between the Scottish Government and COSLA around the setting of sustainable rates. So under the Funding Follows the Child approach, there was clear sort of guidelines set out, and then that was followed by a first set of guidance in 2019 and then further guidance, interim guidance issued last year. And that sets out the detailed step-by-step process that councils have to follow in terms of how they set the rates, looking at what are the costs of delivery, what are the costs to... obviously at the moment still the real living wage commitment that comes as part of that, and how do they engage with providers as part of that process. Now, I think that obviously there are differences and different approaches in terms of what it costs to deliver childcare in different parts of the country, and I think that's reflected somewhat in some of the variance. But what we've seen is actually over time the variance between the highest and lowest rates across the country has come down by about 20%. Since 2017. At the same time, we've seen the amount provided through rates raised by an average of 50% by around 2017. So what we're seeing is we're moving towards an increase in rates generally, and also what we're seeing is more sort of coherence, I suppose, about how that's undertaken. And there's been a range of work that's been undertaken by ourselves, by the Scottish Government, and by the Improvement Service, around improving the quality of data, because one of the real challenges that's come back from both providers and from local authorities is about making these decisions really requires good quality data, and that can be hard to get. So what we've done is undertake a national cost collection exercise by an external party, and that was then provided to councils to allow them to make those decisions based on that data. And then the last thing, I think, obviously, that there is the rates review, which will be undertaken between the Scottish Government and COSLA, which is considering these issues in the round and what more we can do to improve rate-setting processes. And I think, as mentioned in the opening statement, the impact of the Scottish Government's decision to move towards £12 an hour for childcare staff delivering funded entitlement will mean a change again in terms of that rate process.
Okay, well, you know, let me quote Jonathan Broadbury, who's the NDNA's Director of Policy and Communications. Now, he says, our members are telling us they have serious concerns about their sustainability and their ability to continue delivering funded early learning and childcare places. Our research into funding rates that providers are receiving from their local authority is not encouraging. Only three have increased their funding rates sufficiently to allow nurseries to be able to pay their delivery costs. And we need to see the differential funding rates between council and partner providers addressed. So if that's not addressed, we could see nurseries closing, couldn't we?
I think that councils really value their private and voluntary providers and all providers. And actually working together is a key part to what we've spoken about before, about providing that offer of childcare locally that matches the needs of parents. I think in terms of the specific point that I think is raised in that work, I think through the Scottish Government's financial health check, we've not seen the sort of some of the predicted changes that there would be a great drop off in the current places. Indeed, I think the number of private places is essentially stable since the introduction of the policy. So far, it doesn't feel like that's the some of those concerns have come to fruition so far. However, through the rates review and through the work that's been ongoing, we're really committed to trying to make sure that we can do work to create that sense of sector sustainability, because it's in the interest of councils to be able to provide the offers to children and families. And the private sector, the third sector chairmen, are going to be a very important part of that offer.
Well, it may have been stable up till now, but clearly there's a warning that, you know, that it may not be stable in the future and that nurseries could close. Eleanor?
just wanted to come in. So I'd had a chance to look at the data that was published, and I think it was based on an FOI return from August. So we're 3 months on from that, and I would expect that a number of councils, as the usual process, will have set their rates by that point. And the Scottish Government publishes rates data. We collect that from all local authorities every year. So for 22-23, that information was published last December and showed a 6% rise from the previous year. And as Matthew indicated, since the expansion, that's been a 57% increase. And indeed, for 3 to 5-year-olds, rates paid in Scotland were the highest in the UK. So we absolutely appreciate, and the reason we carried out the rates review is that we recognise that there are issues and that we wanted to explore, including around the timing, recognising that in many areas councils work on a kind of term time basis, but that's not always aligned with how businesses operate. So that's something that we are kind of considering carefully as part of those findings. I think, as Matthew also alluded to, we keep a very careful eye on the Care Inspectorate data around capacity, around cancellation rates, and around the number of registrations. And so while we absolutely recognise and kind of engage closely with providers around some of the challenges that they're experiencing, particularly around kind of workforce issues and around costs, as Matthew suggested, you know, capacity has remained stable. Cancellation rates have not spiked over the past 3 years. And I should emphasise that cancellation rates don't suggest that a provider is necessarily closing. And they also relate to kind of turnover, a change of premises, etc. But it's something we review very carefully and engage closely on with our partners in the sector in terms of kind of what response we've set out.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks. I'm going to go swiftly to the Deputy Convener, Sharon Dowie, who's got some questions for you, which follow up this theme. Sharon.
Thank you. Morning. The joint report highlighted that although councils recruited the staff they needed to deliver the expansion, risks relating to recruitment and retaining enough staff remained. The Scottish Government was developing a strategic framework for ELC and school-age childcare workforce, along with an action plan. So can I ask whether the workforce issues set out in the report, including recruitment challenges, difficulties quantifying the extent of workforce movement between sectors, falls in the number of childminders, and a lack of long-term workforce plans will be covered by the actions in the strategic framework?
Yeah, so there's a number of different elements in that, and we're responding to them in a number of different ways. In terms of the workforce movements, the SSSC published some data earlier in the summer just to provide us with that information around those movements, particularly movements between different sectors in terms of the public sector, the private sector and the voluntary sector, to give us that data. And that was clearly one of the recommendations from the Audit Scotland report that we've now been able to deliver on in terms of having that information. What that showed was that people from the private sector, the majority of people who move out of roles within the private sector go to other roles within the private sector as well. In terms of those that go to the public sector, that's roughly proportionate with the scale of the public sector within the system. The one issue that it did highlight was that very few people move out of the public sector into the private and voluntary sector. So there's clearly something in there in terms of the, you know, obviously the positives in terms of people working within the public sector. But in terms of movement, there wasn't any indication that the scale of movement was different from the proportions within the overall system. On childminders, we know that the number of childminders have reduced since the policy was introduced. And as you'll be aware, the government committed in the programme for government to expand on some pathfinder work that we've been doing to increase the number of childminders by 1,000 by 2026. And then obviously the other issue, and it links back to the sustainability issues that we were just discussing there, is we know that sustainability within the private sector links with access to workforce and issues such as paying the real living wage. And again, in the programme for government, ministers committed to providing funding sufficient to pay £12 an hour for relevant staff within the staff who are delivering funded early learning and childcare services. So there's a number of different responses to those elements that are picked up within the Audit Scotland report.
I should have asked at the beginning. Has the strategic framework been published? It was due at the end of the summer, I think.
It's not been published yet. Work has been progressing on it between COSLA and the government. We're obviously looking at what the implications of the announcements within the programme for government, and then also some of the other work that we've been doing in terms of that workforce movement, and see what that what implications that has. But the intention is to publish the output from that this year. I think that's right, Eleanor.
So I think we've been carrying out the actions that were agreed through the working group that includes kind of COSLA colleagues and the unions. So, for example, we announced a waiver of PVG fees. We've been consolidating and simplifying access to continuous professional learning. I think, as Neil said, we want to think carefully about the kind of quite a different approach that was announced in the PFG in terms of early adopters that will consider kind of what childcare looks like from 9 months to the end of primary. And that might look quite different in terms of both the regulatory requirements and the workforce requirements. So we want to take a bit more time to kind of examine that fully with Care Inspectorate, with SSC, with SFC. So it might take a bit longer to do that piece of work properly with those agencies and engaging carefully with COSLA around that. So we anticipate it might be next year before we set out more detail around that. But as I said, we're cracking on with the actions that we'd agreed already as part of it with colleagues who sit on that working group.
So it was originally the summer. You're changing the way you're doing it. It's not going to be this year. It'll be next year. But you're doing some announcements as we go along. Is that what you're saying?
I suppose it's some of the things that are sensible and agreed and that we need to get on and do, we are doing, and we've got agreement to do that. Where we think we need to take a bit more time to think about the implications of a different approach to delivery, which we're trialling in six local authority areas, and those are in the communities that are experiencing kind of most deprivation, and where we've got some findings from where school-aged childcare have been developing that work, we want to kind of take the time to reflect on that. So that might mean, for example, looking at models of family support, which are different from, if you like, traditional ELC delivered in ratio within a setting. And that might look different in terms of the workforce that you want to recruit. So we want to have the time to kind of do that thinking. But absolutely, it doesn't mean that we'll pause on the work that's necessary, for example, to sort of address some of the recruitment and retention issues facing the sector, and to do the planning necessary for the due road expansion. But I think that's where we want to make sure that we're kind of taking the learning from those early adopters and taking the time to consider with partners kind of what might look different as a result of that approach.
So do you have a list of all the things that you've already implemented then?
So I spoke about the PVG fees. That's one area. We're looking at SSC fees. We've published, we've worked with SSC around the staff movement data and understanding those implications. We've started work around workforce planning and development. And I also mentioned around simplification of access to continuous professional learning, and also in terms of working with to ensure that young people understand what sources of funding are already available for them in their kind of training and development. So those are some examples of those actions that we've agreed with colleagues that we need to crack on and do, and we are doing.
Okay, so I obviously don't know when we're going to see it then, so I was going to ask, will the strategic framework include details on the affordability and funding for all the actions?
Certainly any actions will be built into our overall investment going forward investment plan. So yeah, absolutely. So obviously the biggest of those is in terms of the commitment around £12 an hour, and that will be factored into the budget for 2024-25.
Okay, thanks. You mentioned earlier on about the Scottish Social Services Council, or SSC, as you said, has published new data on the data gap that was highlighted in the audit. So does the new SSC data and workforce movement fill the data gap that was highlighted in the report around the movement of ELC workers between sectors? So it fills the full time.
Yeah, it's got very rich data around the movements between different sectors and within sectors.
Okay, and what impact has the new data and workforce movement had on planned actions to mitigate workforce risks?
It's obviously all of that data is feeding in. As I say, the data indicated that the kind of movements from the private and voluntary sector into other areas was broadly proportionate with what you would expect in terms of the scale of the sectors. So it wasn't indicating that in terms of there was a disproportionate movement in particular directions, other than that one issue I mentioned, which was that there tended to be far fewer people moving out of the public sector. So we are factoring that in. But clearly this has to fit within the wider programme of work in terms of retention and remuneration within the early learning and childcare sector, particularly within the private and voluntary sector.
And that was a huge concern, I think, with the private early learning fund providers. Yes. About staff moving from there to the public sector. So has any action been taken in that point?
As I say, the data didn't particularly suggest that the numbers were disproportionate compared to what you would expect. As I say, the majority of people who move out of the private sector move into other private sector roles, but it's clearly something we need to keep a watch on in terms of what those movements are and whether they're an indicator of movement. I suppose the last thing that I would want to say is, just as Eleanor mentioned earlier on, the care inspector assessment of the quality being delivered by across the board in terms of early learning and childcare is very high, and that has to be the credit to staff across all sectors.
Okay, thanks. Well, just a final quick question from me, and you mentioned a couple of times about the real living wage being paid, and that's been announced as an uprate into £12 an hour. I think it's at least £12 an hour is what we're speaking about here. I mean, and you said that this would be funded by the Scottish Government. I mean, do you know for sure that all employers, voluntary sector, private sector, public sector, are all paying their staff this real living wage figure? And do you monitor that? How do you know that?
We do have some data. There was some data collected this summer that showed that 84% of private and voluntary sector providers were paying the real living wage either to all their staff or to those staff who were delivering funded early learning and childcare. And clearly the commitment in terms of £12 an hour, they'll then move that to all staff, and we will monitor. We will have in place arrangements to monitor that.
So, what do you do about the 16%?
Well, as I say, the £12 an hour commitment will respond to that.
Sorry, but what I'm asking, Mr. Rennick, is you said that 84% of providers met the criteria of paying their staff at least the living wage.
Yes.
Meaning 14% didn't. What was it? 84, 16.
Yeah.
16% didn't. So what do you, what leverage have you got over that 16%?
Yeah, so the commitment that we have now given is to making that available, and part of the work that we're doing around that is ensuring that feeds through to the staff.
Because the colleagues wanted to say, in terms of contractual obligations and through the national standard, there's a mechanism there for ensuring that those that are funded are implementing them. So I don't know if Matthew wants to say anything.
No, I think you've made the point there, absolutely. The national standard, which was part of the foundation, I suppose, about how this works, it requires all providers, if they wish to deliver funded hours, to be able to evidence their ability to meet those criteria. Now, many of them are things we've discussed already around the quality under the care inspectorate, but there's a specific item, a specific standard in there around fair work, and that's not just around living wage, but also around the range of other commitments that you'd require to be sort of a good employer. So that's something that councils will be examining through the process that they have, through the contractual arrangements process they have with providers. And I suppose the other thing we've got is there's the ELC Fair Work and Real Living Wage Group, which is considering this issue and what more we can do, because we do recognise that there's more that we could be doing.
Yeah, because that is, as we reflected, I think, in the last evidence session that we had with the Auditor General, that is an implementation group. That's its title, isn't it? It's the ELC Living Wage and Fair Work Implementation Group. So what is its role in ensuring that fair work and living wage conditions are implemented? Matthew Sweeney, I don't know whether you can answer that.
I don't know, Eleanor, I'm not actually on that group, but I understand the remit is primarily looking at what approaches have been taken in different areas, how can we share best practice and understand how we're able to do this. Also, I think there'll be a role in considering, as Neil says, as we move towards a new commitment from the Scottish Government, what does that mean for this implementation approach? And I think there's probably also something for us to think about in that group, to think about actually what are the cross-sectoral issues, because this is not just an issue. I'd imagine in ELC, but actually there'll be a range of areas where we'll need to think about actually the power and ability to influence the passing on of those commitments as well.
OK, well, look, thank you very much indeed. I think that's been a useful session for us. And so can I thank Director General Neil Rennick, you for coming along and leading on this, Evans, Eleanor Passmore, for your input, Matthew Sweeney and Joanna Anderson from COSL, thank you very much indeed for answering our questions and taking part in this morning's discussion. So I will now move the committee into private session. Thank you very much.